We will now pause for station identification. This is NUTS.
What are you doing here?
Are you trying to give me the double talk?
Radio. Shut up and start talking.
And then make a left and come 405 north. From there, just get off Mulholland.
Quiet, numbskulls. I'm broadcasting.
The Talk Alternative is the 405media.com. Good morning. We're here in Los Angeles, California, and you are where you are. It is 7 Pacifico, 10 on the Lesser Coast, and time for the original and classic Gang of 405 here on the 405media.com. You want to talk to us on the live show? It's easy. We don't have a call screener or nothing. It's 877-297-8022. If you want to give us a pop on Twitter, that is simple. It's at the 405 Radio, and we consider ourselves a very easy RT. We'll interact with you and not just favorite your tweet and give you a little pat on the head, send you on your way. If you want to reach us via email, it's the 405 Radio at the 405radio.com. We have podcasts, lots of them, all of our live original talk in the podcasterole, as we say, iTunes, Stitcher, and Spreaker. And, of course, we do live stream on iTunes. Tune in, Live 365, Roku. If you got an old Zune, an MP3 player with a couple of scratchy Radio Shack speakers, we're there. Or if the man limits your data on your smartphone contract, you can actually listen to us via dial-up. I bet you didn't know that. That number, now that's not the same as the call-in number. It's 712-432-8653. You can listen to anything we are streaming on the 405media.com anytime via that dial-up number. So that is kind of cool. Hey, let's say good morning to the gang. They're here. Scott Jones is here. He is Pops Radio on Twitter. He calls himself an independent. He is a lifelong Republican, somewhat moderate, he says. He's a campaign guy. He is your public relations go-to guy. He knows communications. And best of all, he's from Texas, so you can trust him. And he's also the host of Pissed Off Politically Speaking with Scott Jones on the 405media.com. And that's a Monday morning show, folks, bright and early, 7 a.m. Pacific, 10 a.m. Eastern, Pissed Off Politically Speaking with Scott Jones. Good morning, Scott.
Good morning, gang. Glad to be with you.
You are working with Mr. Brett Baer on a book rollout of his, and you wanted to talk about that for a couple of minutes, right?
Well, I just I want to let our listeners know we're going to have a pretty special week coming up the last weekend in May here on this show. As a matter of fact, I am pleased to announce we have confirmed Brett Baer to join us on the Gang of 405 on May 31st. And I'm real proud of the fact that the 405 has been able to score this. I don't know if you know this, John. I don't think I told you. We are the only non-Fox venue that Brett is doing the first week of the book rollout. So
wow. That's great. And I know how these book things work, and there's a pecking order. And oftentimes, if you aren't one of those A-list commentators or, you know, A-list hosts, you go to the back of the line, if they even talk to you at all. I mean, I've been there, so I know what you're saying, man.
Well, I mean, we're going to be in the middle of Bill O'Reilly, Fox and Friends, and all of that. So I'm real proud for the station and the show. You bet. But what makes this special, and I don't usually go all out for a book launch, but this is the story of his son, Paul, and his medical challenges with congenital heart defects. He's had he's 6 years old now, has had three open heart surgeries since birth, but the striking thing about it is 100% of the revenues that Brett Baer receives from the book is going to be donated to pediatric heart research. So
wow.
Not only is Brett somebody I admire immensely and kind of befriended him over the last 2.5 years, this is going to do great work for pediatric heart research. And what's going to be a neat twist, which he seemed kind of touched by, was surprised, on the Gang of 405 on May 31st, Brett will not only join us, but his son Paul himself will chat with at the beginning of the interview. So get your tough questions ready.
We pride ourselves as the most kid-friendly streaming radio site in the Western Hemisphere, and we're going to prove that with 6-year-old Paul.
Paul, on the show. Oh, how exciting.
Is he going to join us for the whole hour? I mean, he can if he wants to.
Well, we're only going to have them for a quarter hour, but...
quarter hour, okay.
Yeah,
fine.
Yeah, but I thought we'd have Paul on at the very beginning and ask him a few questions, and then I wanted to have the opportunity for you and Tammy to talk to Brett about the book, because the following Monday on Pissed Off Politically Speaking, I have dedicated the entire show, and I'm calling it the special heart edition of Pops Radio, and Brett will return to the 405 on my show for a full segment on Monday, June 2nd at 10:35 during the hour. So,
you know, and there's been a lot of poopy heads out there writing about conservatives, and I guess, you know, in all fairness, we could say Brett is probably more conservative than not, and their books, and they're saying things like, well, you know, the purchases are ginned up or the advances are unfair, but this guy's given away all the money to a charitable organization, and you can't fault him for that. That's pretty much on the up and up.
You bet. So I'm real excited for our listeners, both for
which isn't to say that I have a problem with people who keep the profits from their books, but you know, he is beyond reproach in this regard.
What's that? What did the Clintons do with their profits?
Yeah. Do we want to go there?
They pay for.
Hey, and that is Tammy Jackson, and she is the emerging threat from the West Coast. Tammy J on Twitter, and also host of the Tammy Jackson Show Tuesday nights, 10 Eastern, 7 Pacific, and the bossy boss of RightVoiceMedia.com. Hello, Tammy Jackson.
Hello, John. Hello, Scott. Good to be here again early on a Saturday morning for me and you.
And your Tuesday show is a work in progress, but you've got something kind of big coming up at the end of June regarding our good friend Hugh Hewitt, who is a syndicated radio show host who works out of Orange County, California here, which is where we are. Tell us about that.
I organize the Hugh Hewitt radio show Tribbles. That's what they call us. Rush has his ditto heads. Hugh has his Tribbles. And we, you know, the trouble with Tribbles. We make trouble.
And I don't think that the ditto heads organize to the extent that you do. Because you've got a pretty action-packed venue going on for that last weekend of June.
Yeah, and I started this up because every year, Hugh does a Disney Day. And he... KRLA, his main flagship station in the LA area, and Disney coordinate. They choose a day, and it usually centers around a ride that's just opening or been refurbished or something, and he spends the whole show with all of us, but he also spends it with Station Martin, who is...
Does he do the show on the ride, you know? I mean,
no,
I don't know. I'm just asking.
But Dwayne is on a ride. And so, so this is the thing. Dwayne is...
Dwayne is his executive producer.
Yes.
He's another good friend of ours.
Yes, we call him Generalissimo. He's radio blogger on Twitter, 500 and some thousand followers on Twitter. But he is wired for sound on whatever ride he's on. Hugh is at the booth with Station Martin, who is the Disney historian. This is a fount of information. He's doing the regular 12 to 3 p.m. Pacific time broadcast. And we join him. We also go on rides all day. But we go on the rides with Dwayne also. So one year he was on It's a Small World. To this day, he still cannot stand that song, and we tease him incessantly. But
that's a love-hate ride, I got to tell you, as far as Disney's concerned.
And this year, the ride is going to be... it's the train that's in Frontierland that's been refurbished. Maybe Thunder Mountain train or
Thunder
something.
Thunder Mountain, that sounds right.
Yeah. And it's been refurbished. We believe that's the ride. He's going to have his own car, and he tries to set a record every year to see how many times he can go around on. It's a Small World. He might have done 55 rotations.
And we've got some stuff outside of the amusement park as well for people who, you know, are not inclined to pay the admission to go in there. We've got some, you know, events going on. Matter of fact, we're going to try to do a live broadcast of this show from your hotel headquarters in Tustin. So stay tuned for that.
Yeah, so the event starts, Tribble Fest starts Thursday night. We have drinks and dinner. I'm still working on that location. Friday, we're at Disneyland. We're meeting for a lunch from 12 to 2 p.m. In there at House of Blues. That's confirmed. We'll have dinner Friday night, all of us, including Dwayne and his wife. And Dwayne usually selects the venue. Last year, we were at Portillo's. And the years before, we've been at Chili's and other places that were handy to the park. Saturday, we usually have a big event going on, and we will again this year. I'm trying to make it a little more low-key because we're going to have some guests. We may have Michael Ramirez. We may have John Androsic. Well, they've said they will come. So
Five for Fighting, John Androsic.
Yes, and okay. He's a great friend of Hugh Hewitt and the broadcast, and he's also a friend. He raises money for the troops. He's a great friend of the military. And so the thought being, it'd be wonderful, and this is what I'm working toward, to have a barbecue with all of us, with maybe some wounded warriors, some friends that are service friends, SEALs, etc., and have John there and just hang out, and we might have some impromptu jam sessions. Because not only is John Androsic a world-famous musician, Michael Ramirez is a world-famous editorial cartoonist, but he's also a musician, and he loves to play, and he plays a lot of clubs in the area. And then we'll have some other people like Gary and Shelley Eaton, who have the Army You Have band, musicians there. So we may have a lot of fun with a jam session. And that's what happens. But
and we can commit to you that we will not be in any hotels owned by the Sultan of Brunei or any other country which imposes Sharia law.
Absolutely not. But there are people, John, flying from New Hampshire and
It's about damn time they come out here, you know? That's what I got to say.
Arizona.
Hey, Scott, before we go to the break, I want to talk about your show coming up on Monday. You got some A-list guests. Let's hit that real quick, and then we'll take a break and hit the meat and potatoes of the program here.
You bet. Well, Monday we're going to try to do it one more time, but this time with feeling. David Webb will join us. And I've got his cell phone, his phone, home phone, a phone in the toilet. So David Webb will be on the show Monday. We had a glitch last week and missed him. But as many of you know, he's Fox News contributor, co-founder of Tea Party 365, and has his own show on Sirius XM Patriot. And then I thought I'd change it up a little bit. God help me. In my B block, I will have Fox News political analyst Juan Williams in the B block. We've had his son Raffy on my show and on the Gang of 405. So I'm going to see if I can change Juan's Kool-Aid flavor.
Well, you know what? And people kind of roll their eyes when the liberals come on these shows, but Roger Ailes is no idiot. You know, he knows what he's doing over there. And I think guys like Beckel and Williams and, you know, to an extent, Alan Colmes, you know, they add a little bit of seasoning. And I think they sort of enhance the watchability of those programs sometimes, even though we disagree with them all the time.
Well, I think the key distinction on this, John, is I do not like Bob Beckel. I do not care for Alan Colmes at all. I think, as Raffy told us on the Gang of 405 when he was on, you know, Juan has lived the American dream, you know, coming out of the projects and ascending to where he is. And I genuinely think he's a good person, although politically confused. So I wanted to change it up a little bit and have somebody from the other side. And at least Juan has some integrity and doesn't do the faux outrage thing. So I'm really excited to have him on.
Okay, quickly, when we come back, we'll talk about Benghazi as advertised. Rand Paul is making trouble about voter ID. What's up with that? Mitt Romney poking the GOP with a stick about minimum wage. There is a rising tide to dump the head of the Veterans Administration, as well there should be. Eric Chinesky. The Chinesky is hitting the fan, as we say. And also, what in the world is going on with Nigeria, if there's time? We'll do winners, losers, and predictions, because it is the original and classic Gang of 405 on the 405media.com. We'll come right back.
You're on the 405.
Thank you for shopping Amazon.com. When you do, that makes you a sponsor of the 405 Media. Click on the Amazon banner on top of our homepage, then shop. Simple. It costs you nothing. When you think Amazon, click one more time on the 405media.com, then on the Amazon banner. Thank you.
Voces Latinas.
Rubio has 100% rating from AFP. He has like a 97% rating from Heritage. He votes wildly conservative, more conservative than 98% of senators on 98% of the issues. Why fire Rubio over one issue?
Voces Latinas, live only on the 405media.com.
We don't want to fire Ruby over one issue.
We had 40 Hispanics walking around, and all they see, they don't, you know, is pink slip Rubio, pink slip Rubio. Pink slip to me is fire.
Voces Latinas, Mondays, 10 p.m. Eastern, 7 Pacific, only on the 405media.com.
But is it strategically smart to publicly heckle and call him a traitor? Rubio was lambasted publicly by Limbaugh. Michelle Malkin screams shamnesty like it's her job. I mean, shamnesty, shamnesty. Air your grievances with Rubio all you want. But I can't help it when I work with the Latino youth community trying to make them conservative, bring them to the conservative movement. And they're all like, well, Rubio's the only one that cares about us, and they hate him. They yell shamnesty at him.
The 405.
Freedom is never more than one generation away from extinction.
The Friddle Show.
Gay marriage is not even legal in Arizona, so how is this cake discussion even relevant?
The Friddle Show with Crystal Heath.
I mean, this bill, I read it today. You can read it. It's 2 pages long.
The Friddle Show, live Monday nights, 9 Eastern, 6 Pacific.
It's become acceptable to sleep around. Did you know that only 3% of Americans abstain from sex until they're married?
The Friddle Show, family-friendly, politically incorrect news commentary from a young Christian conservative perspective.
And if my disagreeing with a lifestyle due to my religious beliefs is now the same as hatred, then I apparently hate 97% of Americans.
Live original talk only on the 405media.com.
The president, you know, he wasn't too far off base when he said that we're no longer a Christian nation, because quite frankly, we're not. The general populace does not have a biblical worldview.
You're on the 405.
CSC Talk Radio is proud to be a part of 405media.com.
Listen to Beth Ann and Common Sense Conversations Talk Radio weeknights, 8 p.m. and 1 a.m. Eastern, here on the 405media.com.
When the days are cold and the cards all fold and the saints we see are all made of gold.
This is Katie Pavlich. You're listening to the 405 Radio.
The talk alternative is the 405media.com. It's Shinseki, all right? Scott corrected me on that during the break. I think I said that last week, too. Gersh darn it. Eric Shinseki. Well, whatever. He needs to get the HE double hockey sticks out of the VA because there's guys dying on waiting lists. Let's get going on Benghazi here. The select committee has picked the sharpest legal minds in Congress, we're told. Trey Gowdy, Susan Brooks, Jim Jordan, Mike Pompeo, Martha Roby, Peter Roskam, Lynn Westmoreland. Trey Gowdy is a former prosecutor who never lost a case in 16 years. How about that? Democrats seem kind of unserious about this, not surprisingly, and they haven't decided whether they will even seat their 5 representatives. Scott, there's a poll that says I think 72% of Americans want more investigations on Benghazi. But like everything Democrats do, most Americans disagree with. Are you surprised that they're not serious, or is this what you expected? And there really aren't any Democrats breaking ranks on this.
Well, you know, what's interesting, John, I think they're almost what I would say a headless horseman on this issue. I don't think they know exactly what to do. I think they're sticking their finger up in the air to see which way the wind would blow. Obviously, the hyper-partisans are, screw them, we don't want to do this. But I would note that 27 Democrats voted with the Republican majority to form this, and of course they did it for political reasons. But
and this silly notion of putting as many Democrats as Republicans on the panel, that crashed and burned. Nobody was going to buy that.
Megyn Kelly stunk up her show last night having Alan Combs on there whining about it. I mean, you know, John, it is just another example of the hypocrisy. But all these rules and all the screws they've turned on the GOP are going to come back to haunt them, because I really do think we're going to win back the Senate. So, but even then, they'll be screeching and hollering and whining. But the bottom line is, I'll sum up my thought this way. I think they're on the wrong side of history on this, and certainly based on the polling I've seen, which you cited, the American people are not with them on this. But I think they have the real potential to get a black eye if they play this, I'm going to take my tinker toys and go home and not play. There are still unanswered questions. Weekly, we're having new information coming out indicating that the Obama administration, surprise, surprise, lied to the American people. And I think the broader public, even the low information voters that are waking up from their slumber, are probably at their limit when you combine the lies on health care, the IRS, and Benghazi and all of these things. I think the people have had enough and have said, all right, let's drive some accountability here. But they really run the risk, the Democrats, John, of getting a real black eye if they do this petulant act.
You know, Tammy, there are people even on our side, I think Charles Krauthammer, they're somewhat wringing their hands about this. And, you know, what he says is there's a danger that this will be politicized. I think, paraphrasing, he said, you know, this can't be speeches. This has got to be questions. You know, everything needs to end with a question mark. But it's baked into the cake that the GOP will be accused of making this political. So we're kind of damned if we do and damned if we don't on this, right?
Possibly, but I think we'd be more damned if we didn't have the select committee, and most of us
exactly.
were calling for this committee for 2 years. We want consequences, we want good questions, and we want solid answers. We don't want these highly redacted answers. And the thing is, what's amazing is, I'm sure everybody that listens to this has been following the news that in, I believe, Yemen, how they vacated the embassies there because there were terror threats. So this whole meme of an Arab Spring is nothing but, you know, vain imaginings by Barack Obama. And he knows that he was in the wrong, but of course he will not admit that he made some grave, grave errors that cost America lives. And Hillary knows that she's in the wrong, even though we see her front and center telling everybody that this is pretty much a waste of time and do we really want to waste taxpayer money doing this. Oh my goodness, you know, four lives. We've got to stay focused on this like a laser. I think
especially since it's clear that from the get-go Hillary and everybody else in that stinkhole was bound and determined to lie about a YouTube video.
Oh,
that's what makes us even more insidious.
They absolutely lied about it. And then Obama lied about saying it was a YouTube video in that second debate. He tried to say that no, I called it a terror attack. Absolutely, he did not. He lied about it. Everybody connected with the administration lied about it. Everybody connected with state lied about it. We want to get some truth out there. And they've got some great people. I mean, I was so heartened to have Trey Gowdy, selected chair, and these other people on there. I would have liked to have had Jason Chaffetz because he was fantastic during the Benghazi hearings, and he's very pointed and direct in his questioning and very determined to also get to the bottom of this. But we've got some good legal minds. These are litigators. They're very good at the interrogatives. They know what they need to ask, and Trey Gowdy will chair it magnificently.
Yeah, and I think I was looking up and down this list. Some of these Congress people have only been around since 2010 or 2012. They're kind of the fresh faces. You know, obviously, Trey Gowdy is the seasoned prosecutor here. But as you said, you know, there's no Chaffetz on the panel. And these folks are just sort of, you know, in their breakout mode here.
They are, but they may have. What I like is they're not old-timey politicians. I don't think they're in it for the politics. I believe when you hear Trey Gowdy speak, when you hear some of these other people that have helped with the Benghazi hearings speak, you can tell that it's something that resonates down deep, that they have an extreme outrage over the fact that everybody is covered up, that we lost a sitting ambassador, first time since the Jimmy Carter administration, and three other brave Americans in an attack that probably could have been prevented had the warnings, had the help and assistance been sent that was requested. And we know that they saw in real time what happened that night, and yet Obama and State Clinton were absent when that 3 a.m. phone call came.
Scott, you sort of see a barrage of pushback narrative and public relations, I guess, from the left right now about this. Do you get the feeling that this may go the way of, say, shutdown or budget negotiations or the debt ceiling where, you know, suddenly an NBC poll falls out of the sky that says Americans are sick about Benghazi and they want to move on, and the finger in the wind wing of the GOP says, well, we got to cut and run here. You get kind of nervous about that. I do.
You know, maybe not as much as you, John, for this reason. Number one, while I admire Jason Chaffetz, he's got the ISIS stink on him and too many appearances on Fox News. I think these fresh faces...
That's a good point.
These fresh faces were chosen for a reason. They haven't been on the talk show proffering conclusions on evidence the way Chaffetz and others have. Trey Gowdy, while he's made TV appearances, he's built a reputation, as you indicated and Tammy indicated, as a tough prosecutor. You know, bottom line on this, number one, they're going to have to swing those numbers, John, by 50 percentage points, because 3 out of 4 Americans think there's something here, and 67% of them think it needs further investigation. You know, you reach a point where doth the lady protest is too much, and I don't necessarily consider Pelosi a lady. I consider her an alien from another planet, but, you know, bottom line is...
By the way, I want to apologize for the assault on your eyes, those of you who saw our website and the fashion taste of Rosa DeLauro from Connecticut.
All of them...
She looks like she went into your grandma's house, ripped down the drapery, and, you know, made suits out of it. That's what she dresses like.
Or
aging hipster, as we say.
Or tore the upholstery off the sofa. But, you know, bottom line is, John, and I'm going to ask this question of Juan Williams when I have him on Monday. What are you afraid of? Okay? You've got nothing.
I think that's an excellent question.
And they can't answer it, okay? Bottom line is let this investigation or hearing run its course. And if we're wrong, if the GOP is wrong, they're going to end up with egg on their face. What is so scary to you guys that another stab at the truth, given what's come out in the last few weeks, is so intimidating? And why are you guys so shrill in your opposition when we have 4 families with no good answers and an American public that thinks it ought to be looked at? What is the objection to getting the truth? Are you against the truth? Is that what this is all about? But these memes about the cost of it, well, cut 2 of Obama's golf trips and pay for it, okay? Bottom line is the family deserves answers. And I think, John, it is the culmination of a broader base of people in the United States are tired of being lied to by this administration. So I think those poll numbers reflect, okay, let's let it go ahead. But I'm going to ask Juan, what's your objection to finding the truth here?
And we have Pat Smith and Charlie Woods that I've heard speak several times. And Charlie is just amazingly gracious. But those are 2 parents that have been front and center and have said, we have never been given an explanation. There's been lies and stonewalling, and that's it. And they lost their kids. Come on.
I think if I can swipe a bullet point from Rush here, what he has said was, unlike all the other Obama scandals, this really has nothing where at its core you can say, you know, well, Obama was trying to do what's right for the country, or he was trying to give people health care, or he was trying to, you know, give us alternative energy sources. So all these other stink bombs that have been created, you know, based on some lousy policy of Obama, are much different from this, because this was something that really did nothing but harm to people. And there are families who lost loved ones. You know, there are 30 witnesses nobody can seem to find. I'm sure they'd like to come out and tell their story. There's just nothing good at the core of this that Obama can say, well, I was trying my best, you know, I was trying to do the right thing. BS. He was covering his tail because he created the fairy tale of the Arab Spring. You know, that crashed and burned in Benghazi, and he had to make up another lie to cover that.
Yep. John, if I might, let me give you a line item example of what I think could come out of this, and it may be in a little bit in the weeds. But, you know, last week we had our liberal alter ego, Dominic Nani, on the show, and he kept pushing back on me that Barack Obama sent help to Benghazi. Well, we all know that's BS. He mobilized some assets that re-scrambled, but I think what's going to come out of this is there may not have been a stand-down order, but, you know, having been close enough to it and worked for, you know, 3 U.S. presidents, I understand that the president has to issue an order for cross-border incursion into a foreign country. I don't think he offered a stand-down order. I just don't think the president executed a cross-border incursion order, and I think that's going to come out. He did nothing, which is worse than, you know, not sending help or whatever. He left them hanging, wondering whether they were go or no go, and it's going to be an embarrassment for this administration. But
and he did it, Scott, because he was trying to avoid the embarrassment of looking bad when he had told the whole world that all
going into an election.
That all his bowing and scraping and saying things were simmering down in the Middle East because of his gentle talk and his appeasement of those Islamists in the region, even though he had snubbed our greatest ally, Israel. So he wanted to avoid that embarrassment.
My final thought on it is, and I've said it before on this show, this is not a complicated case. This, in the beginning, middle, and the end, the Obama administration's response to this wasn't about good military policy or strategies. Nope. It wasn't about diplomacy. It was simply a preservation of a narrative during a campaign season that infected what should have been leadership command decisions, turn into people like that snot-nosed Vitter and Ben Rhodes and all of that running around of how do we talk about it.
And correct me if I'm wrong, but there's a story out there that says that while this was going down, Obama was off with somebody working on his debate.
Well, that was...
Did you guys hear that?
I didn't hear that.
I have not heard that yet.
But Tommy Viator said to Brett Baer in his interview, you know, live, that President Obama was never in the damn Situation Room.
Yeah, and I did hear that.
And so there's going to be some embarrassing things come out about this administration. But for the life of me, guys, I do not understand why at this point these liberal sycophants would defend this president to the last man over getting the truth for the American people.
And the mainstream media, Scott.
They're an abject failure. I agree with Bill O'Reilly that they're a farce. But why they would defend Barack Obama, what is clearly incompetence, over, you know, getting the truth for the American people and the four families that lost their loved ones. You know, I can't even relate to that, guys.
There's really two pieces to this, and the first one we talked about earlier, which is the notion that they could have, but they did not, send any support into Benghazi to fend off this attack, which I think occurred over the span of about, I don't know, 7+ hours or something.
Yeah.
And they were watching it real time, right?
Like,
correct me if I'm
nine
wrong.
9 hours, and they were watching it real time.
9 hours.
That is correct.
The other thing is, you know, why did they lie about doing what they did or not doing what they did? And I just don't think you can get beyond those two things. And I don't think, you know, there are any good reasons or excuses other than, you know, political CYA in an election year.
That's what it is. And it's an embarrassment.
And I heard early on, this is really interesting because I have a lot of friends that are retired military, and one person that had been U.S. Air Force intelligence and had a nephew in intelligence now, even now he's there. And he told me, and this wasn't anything that was a need-to-know sort of deal, that within half an hour, AFRICOMS had sent the message to the White House that it was an active attack, and the White House had received that message. And then what happened from then was complete and utter failure because nothing was done.
And to me, guys, the whole tit for tat over the talking points and who edited them and, you know, the video lied to the people, certainly that's important. But to me, what is galactically more important than that?
I think that seems like inside baseball to a lot of people.
Well, they want prima facie evidence that the administration lied. I think the American people are already there and know he lied. I mean, it's clear that the video thing was BS. But what is galactically more important to me is command decisions made based on politics versus what can be done to save our people and what a real commander-in-chief in that position would have done if it weren't for, as you say, John, CYA during a political campaign. And if that turns out to be the case, that is just disgusting to me.
Plain.
We're going to move on. Rand Paul is going wobbly on voter ID, and he doesn't believe there is a such thing as voter fraud. We'll talk about that. We'll talk about Mitt Romney and the minimum wage, and Eric Shinseki got that right this time, and maybe a little bit about Nigeria as well. We'll have the winners and losers segment at the end of the show, along with predictions, and your calls if you got them, 877-297-8022. It's the original and classic Gang of 405 here on the 405media.com. We'll be right back.
You're on the 405.
Thank you for shopping Amazon.com.
When you do, that makes you a sponsor of the 405 Media. Click on the Amazon banner on top of our homepage, then shop. Simple. It costs you nothing. When you think Amazon, click one more time on the 405media.com, then on the Amazon banner. Thank you.
This is Tammy Jackson inviting you to join me on the Tammy Jackson Show every Tuesday night at 7 p.m. on the 405media.com. Put down that remote and tune into the show that covers politics, guns and the Second Amendment, religious liberty, sanctity of life, the military, and more. I host newsworthy guests and work hard to be a conservative radio show that is not like all the others. So save Tuesday nights at 7 p.m. Pacific for me, Tammy Jackson, on the 405media.com.
The 405 Media is on Blurt. Check out our homepage, the405media.com. Click on the Get Blurt banner, then install on your smartphone or tablet. Get audio alerts from the 405 Media on upcoming programs and events. Blurt and the405media.com. It's John Grant here, owner and program director of the405media.com. We don't really pass around the hat or the collection plate in social media. We do have a donate button on our website. We'd be happy to be part of your advertising presence for Right of Center Talk. But the best way you can help us pay the bills at no additional cost to you is by the Amazon Associates Program. I'm sure you know the drill, but I'll fill you in. Click on the Amazon banner at the top of our homepage, the405media.com. That will take you to Amazon.com and identify you as one of our listeners. If you make a purchase, the405media.com gets a little something, you know, for the effort. You can buy anything under the sun at Amazon.com. And when you do, you support our growing talk and media operation. Team clothing, collectibles, books, everything. If you're going to buy it anyway, why not send a little bit our way? It'll cost you nothing. So remember, click on the Amazon banner on top of the page, then shop till you drop. Amazon.com and the405media.com. Thank you.
Hi, this is Dana Perino, and you're listening to the 405 Radio.
And there she is, speaking of Fox News rock stars, Dana Perino. It is the original classic gang of 405 here on the405media.com. It's John Grant in Los Angeles. Scott Jones is in Texas. Tammy Jackson is in Oregon. A couple of housekeeping things here. We like to point you at our website. Servative, also known as Stephen Crawford, has a new piece out there. It's Nadra Enzi, right? Hood Conservative, that's what he calls himself, Tammy?
Yeah, his real name is Nadra.
Okay, Hood Conservative uncovers endemic racism. We won't go into it here. You can read it. It's a great piece. Also, believe it or not, we have got something going on I just can't figure out. We did a short blast on Ripon College, which is in Ripon, Wisconsin, the birthplace of the Republican Party, and they are going against the grain on selfies, and a lot of colleges are saying they don't want selfies at graduation, but Ripon College says, let it rip, take your selfies. So we're getting a lot of hits on that piece, people. I don't know what it is, but it's out there. Also, want to point out our partner podcasts. You want to listen to Cooper Talk, our guy in Burbank, Stephen Cooper, talks to stars, talks to musicians, comedians, always got a good show out there every week. The Chris Brake Show from Indianapolis, Rot.org from Virginia, and Orange County's John Matthews with that radio show. Marty O'Sullivan is in New Jersey, and he has the Marty O Show, and something brand new in our video section from Josh Smith. You remember him, he's been on some shows a couple times ago. He does a video podcast with a partner called Jean-Pierre somebody, Some Things Considered, a pretty funny show. So anyway, let us talk about Rand Paul and voter ID. I read a great piece in Hot Air from Ala Pundit, and he sort of goes over the players here and the timeline as far as Rand Paul and voter ID is concerned. And Ala Pundit speculates that Rand Paul's bumpy relationship with minorities is sort of pushing him in the direction of walking back voter ID, which I think you folks would agree is a big deal to a lot in the GOP. Obviously, Rand said some things about the Civil Rights Act, which tend to haunt him from time to time. I think he had some early efforts toward outreach at black colleges, and those didn't go well. Scott, I'll kind of throw it to you first. You know, Ala Pundit thinks Rand won't win primaries. He won't be the nominee in 2016. But he sort of worries that he sets up a fight and a distraction that the other side will use against us,
with voter ID, similar to immigration in 2012. What do you think about that?
Well, again, it's another one of those wedge issues, and I don't think anybody doubts that Rand Paul is seriously considering, if not outright already running for the GOP nomination. Again, this is another one of those situations, John, in my view, and, you know, no offense to Rand Paul. I think he's got a lot of strong attributes, but he's going squishy on it because, you know, potentially public polling or, you know, the MSNBC class would be critical of him. You know, either you believe that is a good effort and should get behind it, or you don't. And you need to state that. And I think he's gone squishy on it. And I think from a primary voter standpoint, John, it's going to hurt him. I mean, just, you know, state your position, be absolute in it, and quit doing this wishy-washy almost, and I hate to say this, no offense to Governor Romney, you know, squishiness on an issue.
Yeah, we're going to talk about him, too, and his appearance on Morning Joe and the minimum wage. But Tammy, it just seems like, you know, Rand Paul's efforts at outreach mean he is pulling planks off the platform wherever he thinks it will personally suit him. And we'll talk about, you know, drug legalization, you know, in this case, voter ID. I hate to say it because everybody doesn't like to hear about Reagan all the time, but Reagan did not give all these issues away in order to get the other side to like us more. And Rand likes to compare himself to Reagan. Paul Kanger would probably disagree with that, but you know, Reagan was not in favor of giving away party planks.
He definitely was not. Reagan had a platform of principles he stood on, as Paul Kanger notes in his book, 11 Principles of a Reagan Conservative, and he never wavered. He never wavered on life, on lower taxes, on limited government, etc. Now I see Rand Paul doing all this wavering and waffling, and I'm just a little bit astounded because he keeps walking back positions, and that's not what we want in leaders. And I've been told forever that Rand Paul is so principled, and he's not as isolationist as his dad, but he's very principled. It goes on and on and on. Well, it's not principled to change in order to accrue favor with a certain sector of the voting population. And that's what I see happening right now. Instead, what we need to do, and what Rand Paul ought to do and join in, is we ought to get better and better at messaging the fact that it has historically been the Democrats that have been not in favor of civil rights. It was the Democrats, it was LBJ and those people that did not want the Civil Rights Act. They did not want civil rights for blacks. It has been the Republicans since the time of Lincoln who have favored equal access, who have favored the civil rights for everybody. And we need to be messaging that. We don't need to be capitulating on things that really matter, like voter ID. What's the big deal with voter ID? You have to show ID to do anything in this country, to pick up prescription drugs at the drugstore. You have to show you have to show identification. Now, is that something that's racist? There's something inherently wrong with this.
Yeah, I think one of the tweets that was in the A La Pundit piece said that, you know, Rand Paul was somewhat taken aback that, you know, the primarily black audience he was speaking to felt voter ID was a racial issue. And perhaps, you know, this move of his is just sort of a Band-Aid to walk that back, Scott.
Well, the Democrats, in typical fashion, made it a racial issue. I think that audience who listens to the liberal left, they have always, you know, when they don't have a fact-based, you know, meritorious argument on the facts, you know, they use the race card in it. And if there's one issue where they have just banged home the notion that, you know, voter ID laws would disenfranchise or disproportionately impact the community of color, I think that's taken. So I'm a little shocked that Rand would be so naive as to think that they wouldn't look at it that way. But you know, I know, and everybody else knows, you have to almost have an ID to go to a public restroom today, that it is a faux issue. And, you know, I'm just disappointed to see Rand Paul going squishy on it for the convenience of you know, his electoral posturing.
On a similar subject, Mitt Romney puts on his compassionate conservative hat and said on Morning Joe that the GOP should commit to raising the minimum wage. And this is what I'm sort of talking about. Again, he sees this as an outreach issue, but it just seems like what he does and what Rand Paul does and Jeb Bush does is they just send us down this path of perpetual internal struggles. You know, this is the guy, Scott, who coined the term self-deportation, Mitt Romney, and now he believes that a higher minimum wage is the key to getting more Hispanic votes. What the heck's he talking about?
Well, again, this is another example of pandering, and this is why the GOP lags on the bell curve of winning over, you know, non-traditional voter groups, in that it is so transparent. I mean, couple it with what we just talked about, John. You know, you talk about raising the minimum wage just kind of across the board and buying into that narrative. You've got Rand, you know, backing off or going squishy on the voter idea thing. Those moves are so transparent, when I think there is such a stronger argument. And granted, we've had crappy messaging the last two election cycles.
Well, it just seems to be issues that either Americans don't care about or we're winning on. And I'll throw climate change in there. John Huntsman was out flapping his gums about the imperative that the GOP address climate change. Where did that come from?
Well, that's the strategy of death by a thousand cuts. These are the these are the GOP's weakest issues, and people like Mitt Romney and Rand Paul can't stay on the high road and paint the picture that a vibrant, growing economy lifts all boats. Screw the minimum wage, okay? We want you to make maximum wage. You know why? Because for every one job applicant, there's three jobs out there, like we used to be. But they want to get down into the weeds and talk about these wedge divisive issues, which are our weak underbelly, and they play right into the Democrat hands of dragging them off the high road of the stronger economic message. And when I see Mitt and Rand do those kind of things, it's just kind of a facepalm. You know, oh my God, we've got so many other strong things to talk about. Relate minimum wage to building an economy which has languished under this president, and do it in a way that it means something to people.
It just seems like, and I hate to dredge up Reagan again, but it seems like he was a guy who got more done with less. I mean, he did not have majorities in Congress. You know, you stop and think about what Ronald Reagan would have done with, you know, George Bush's Congress, right?
Yeah.
I mean, again, he had struggles with the GOP, and a lot of it was the establishment GOP, but he did not go down a path where he felt that he had to give away core issues in order to make the party more viable.
And you think where he really shone, working with Maggie Thatcher and the Pope, and they called out the Soviet Union, USSR, for what they were, as the evil empire. He would not back down. He was the one, he said, no, you keep that Mr. Gorbachev tear down this wall in the speech, Peter Robinson, keep it in there, because I'm going to say that. And people scoffed at him and joked around about his ideas, but he knew that ideas mattered and words mattered, and he did not capitulate.
We're going to take a break and come back, and we will see if we can squeeze in some talk of the VA and allegations that new VA hospitals in different cities were doing the same thing with the phantom waiting list. And we'll also talk about, if we can, the stuff going on with the kidnapped girls in Nigeria. Your phone calls, if you got them, 877-297-8022. The original and classic Gang of 405 returns in a second.
405.
Thank you for shopping Amazon.com. When you do, that makes you a sponsor of the 405 Media. Click on the Amazon banner on top of our homepage, then shop. Simple. It costs you nothing. When you think Amazon, click one more time on the 405media.com, then on the Amazon banner. Thank you.
Voces Latinas.
Rubio has 100% rating from AFP. He has like a 97% rating from Heritage. He votes wildly conservative, more conservative than 98% of senators on 98% of the issues. Why fire Rubio over one issue?
Voces Latinas, live only on the 405media.com.
We don't want to fire Rubio over one issue.
We had 40 Hispanics walking around, and all they see, they don't, you know, is pink slip Rubio, pink slip Rubio. Pink slip to me is fire.
Voces Latinas, Mondays, 10 p.m. Eastern, 7 Pacific, only on the 405media.com.
But is it strategically smart to publicly heckle and call him a traitor? Rubio was lambasted publicly by Limbaugh. Michelle Malkin screams shamnesty like it's her job. I mean, shamnesty, shamnesty. Air your grievances with Rubio all you want, but I can't help it when I work with the Latino youth community trying to make them conservative, bring them to the conservative movement, and they're all like, well, Rubio's the only one that cares about us, and they hate him. They yell shamnesty at him.
You're on the 405.
Off the grid.
And he's also the only person I've ever seen that could write, my dog just rolled over on Facebook and get like 62 likes.
Just a correction, I'm the best looking person in social media too.
Off the grid with Matt Hockman and Beckett Adams.
You have men in the United States Army running for cover and hoping the police show up.
You know, the base is a soft target that's filled with brave Americans, but they got their hands tied.
I'm sure the jihadists completely consider it a soft target. It's like a shopping mall, or like you said, a school. It's probably worse than a shopping mall, because at least here in Arizona, you're allowed to carry.
In several of these shootings, Jared Lautner in Arizona, the Sandy Hook shooting, a number of these shootings always involved somebody who was desperately unhealthy in the head, but for some reason, the argument always turns into get away from my gun. What can we do to maybe help people like this?
Wednesdays, 9 p.m. Eastern, 6 Pacific, only on the 405media.com.
You're on the 405.
This is Tammy Jackson inviting you to join me on the Tammy Jackson Show every Tuesday night at 7 p.m. on the 405media.com. Put down that remote and tune into the show that covers politics, guns and the Second Amendment, religious liberty, sanctity of life, the military, and more. I host newsworthy guests and work hard to be a conservative radio show that is not like all the others. So save Tuesday nights at 7 p.m. Pacific for me, Tammy Jackson, on the 405media.com.
Hi, this is retired Lieutenant Colonel Alan West, and you're listening to the 405 Radio.
The talk alternative is the 405media.com. We're in the final segment of the Saturday morning original and classic Gang of 405. Canusa Sports Desk is coming up next. If you're listening live and if you're listening to the podcast, they'll probably be next as well. It's John Grant here in Los Angeles, Tammy Jackson up in Oregon, Scott Jones in Texas. New allegations about fake waiting lists in other VA locations. I believe the Fox News article mentioned Wyoming as one of them. Veterans groups, politicians calling for the resignation of the head of the VA, Eric Shinseki. Scott, would the worst thing they could do be to can him and sort of pretend all the problems go away? Or focus, I guess, on the larger systemic problems with the VA, which is that they just can't manage their patient load, and there are veterans who are not getting the care they deserve.
Well, John, it may surprise you, and maybe it doesn't surprise you. I'm not ready to, as Boehner said, join the chorus for Shinseki's ouster for a couple of reasons. Number one,
I don't think it accomplishes much. I think it'll be largely a cosmetic solution. You're right.
It doesn't, number one, and you run the risk of, okay, well, we did that, so we don't go down into the bowels of this thing and fix the problem. Number two, he just hasn't been there that long. I mean, this has been a perpetual problem with the VA. I mean, think about it. 1.6 million or whatever the number was of patient loads nationwide. It's poorly managed. It's got antiquated systems. I think we need better line managers and better facility managers. And I would hold Shinseki accountable for getting to the bottom of what's going on. I know he has deployed an IG group to Arizona, but there, you mentioned Wyoming. There's also issues, I believe, with we have Lackland and Kelly Air Force Base in San Antonio, and these are large population centers that are served by these folks. I want them to drive it down to the hospital management level and fix the damn problem, not just throw Shinseki out and wash their hands and say, looky what we did.
I agree, Tammy. Do you think there's some benefit to keeping this guy around and saying, look, you know, it's time to clean this up?
I'm not really big on ousting Shinseki either. And what I want to tell people is, look at this, folks. This is federally managed health care. See what it does?
Yep.
It does nothing. It stinks. People die. They get pork. Care. And the people in this instance are our vets who deserve the greatest care in the world, and they're getting this rotten, stupid, damn federal health care. It just makes me furious.
Okay, we got to go. Winners and losers. Scott, go first. And predictions.
Okay, my winner, reluctantly, better late than never, is John Boehner for putting the legislation out there and getting it passed for the Select Committee on Benghazi. My loser of the week is New York Magazine, who did a misogynist, awful hit piece on CBS's Lara Logan, who is under fire for some bad reporting, but they went... You know, they accuse us of being the war on women. This was the most awful piece I've ever seen, attacking her sex life and all of that over, you know, some bad reporting. It was just awful. My prediction is that the Benghazi Select Committee will find that the president did not order cross-border incursion or help in any sincere way to the folks in Benghazi. Mobilized assets but never gave in a go order. That's my prediction.
Okay, Tammy, hit it.
Okay, my loser, the biggest loser, and the biggest denunciation loser in the nation is Al Sharpton, who once again has a mashup done about him and all his errors, and nobody can understand him. My winner.
It was funny. It was funny.
It was very.
It was a hoot.
It
yes,
was
it
very
was.
Funny. It was well done. My winners are Phelan McAleer and McElhenney, Magdalena Seguieta, who dared to pursue the Gosnell movie project and have surpassed their $2.1 million goal with 2.5 days to go. What they're hoping is to get more and more donors now, not for the money necessarily, because you can give $1 each, but they'd like to be able to hit the networks with, say, 50,000 donors in their pockets and say, look at this, these people want this. My prediction is that they will produce the Gosnell movie, and all of America will see the veil will be lifted on the horror that was Kermit Gosnell.
All righty, winners. All the moms out there, happy Mother's Day.
Woo. Yay!
Loser, Michael Sam, you know who he is. He may not get drafted or be a really, really, really late draft picked, mercy draft by some owner that wants to make a statement. If you don't believe me, consider how long Tim Tebow bounced around until it was clear he couldn't play in the league. Prediction, the Pope is going to make some pro-life statements soon. Everybody's going to forget about the redistribution stuff, trust me. And if you read what he said... He didn't say what the left wants you to think he said, okay? That's it for the original classic Gang of 405 here on the 405media.com. We'll talk to you next week, Saturday. And it's the Canusa Sports Desk coming up next. Until then, John Grant here. We'll be talking to you.
The proceeding was recorded earlier because we were ashamed to do it now.
Until you realize that you should go. Left. I bet you even know where we
could go, when it all fucks up. You put your head in my hands. It's a super.